Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening and a warm welcome to this year's edition of the Falling Walls Lab 2020. My name is Charlotte van Veldhoven. I'm a moderator within my own company, Charlie Speaks, and it is a great pleasure for me to be moderating this edition. And ladies and gentlemen, we are going to have a truly exciting evening. Which are the next walls to fall in science and technology? Who has groundbreaking ideas that can truly change the world we live in and impact our society? Tonight, we will have a chance to listen to some brilliant minds and be inspired by their ideas, knowledge, and creativity. So let me share with you what we are about to do tonight. Well, as you might know, Falling Walls Lab is an international forum for the next generation of early career researchers, innovators, trailblazers, creators, and visionaries. Its aim is to promote exceptional ideas and connect promising scientists and entrepreneurs from across the globe. And each year, academic institutions can host their local Falling Walls editions to showcase the quality and diversity of their region's most innovative minds. And of course, the KU Leuven is part of this. And rightly so, because ladies and gentlemen, last Wednesday, Leuven was awarded with the title of Capital of Innovation, and this is quite an achievement. So what is on the program tonight? Well, as said, it is going to be truly exciting. We are going to have some top quality candidates, 11 in total, and they are called Labsters. And they can present their research, their business idea, their visions to peers, to a jury of experts that we have here in the audience, and of course you as an audience can also select the winners. So how are they going to do that? Well, ladies and gentlemen, they only have 3 minutes and they can only present 3 slides. Well, the slides will be presented on the screen behind me. And what we are going to do afterwards is that as soon as those 3 minutes are over, the microphone will be turned off. So we do hope indeed that, well, they have been trained in advance, that they keep within the time track records. Okay, so what are we going to do right now? We are about to start, but of course we also have a lovely jury. And as said before, you, as the audience, can also cast a vote. And after all 11 candidates have given their presentations, we will show you a link on the screen where you will be able to cast your vote. And after that break, at 9:45 approximately, we will start the awards ceremony. So before we will start the first pitch, let me introduce to you our highly valued and, of course, carefully selected jury. The chair of the jury is Reine Meilaerts, who is the Vice Rector for Research Policy at the KU Leuven. We have Bart Geers, the spin-off manager at KU Leuven Research and Development. Ortwin de Graaf, Professor of English Literature and Communication Specialist at the KU Leuven. Jason Passaris, who is the winner of the Falling Walls Lab Leuven 2019. Marianne Verhelst, Professor Electrical Engineering and passionate about science communication. And Koen Wouters, a science journalist of the national news channel VRT. And before we get started, because we actually have a live audience here as well, I just want you really to give a big shout. Are you ready for this event? Okay. I'm happy to hear that, and also I hope that the audience back home is cheering as loudly as you are doing over here. Ladies and gentlemen, we are going to commence with the first presentation. I wish you all the best of luck, dear candidates, but above all, also a lot of fun. It's a pleasure for me to announce to you Simon van Eindhoven. He's from Belgium, he has a PhD in electrical engineering that he is applying for, and he will talk about breaking the wall of drug-resistant epilepsy. The floor is yours.
Imagine you're on holiday, just strolling around the market, enjoying an ice cream, then suddenly a terrible scream. Before you realize what happens, people start yelling, the panic spreads, and everyone now tries to get out of there. Your heart is racing, you drop your ice cream, and you just run. Scary, right? Well, this is what happens in the brain of 1 out of every 100 people because they have epilepsy, a disease in which some brain cells generate strong electrical discharges at unpredictable times. Just like the scream infects the crowd with panic, those discharges spread through a network of neurons and cause seizures with dramatic symptoms like falling, shaking, but also disturbed emotions. So epilepsy patients live in constant fear of losing control. In 1/3 of cases, medication does not help. Luckily, engineers like me can do something about it. The only real cure is to surgically remove the brain tissue responsible for the discharges, just as if we would take out that troublemaker on the market to avoid future panic. But how to find it? Well, on the market, microphones could detect when there's an abnormal sound. And at that moment, taking pictures of the crowd can reveal where the panic starts spreading. It works the same in medical imaging. We measure a patient with EEG, like microphones on the head that listen to electrical brainwaves, and with functional MRI, like a camera with a slow shutter speed that makes images of active brain regions. Both of these techniques are very limited, but they're complementary. By combining their data, we can discover a lot more. So in multimodal imaging, 1 + 1 = 3. Unfortunately, on the market, we can only observe many people at once. And similarly, EEG and fMRI measure only weak and noisy signals from many parallel brain processes that involve billions of neurons. So even though this technique is already part of surgery planning in many hospitals, it's often not successful. That's why in my PhD, I develop algorithms that extract more information from that is hidden in the data. By better modeling the subtle link between EEG and fMRI, those algorithms separate the raw data into relevant patterns, each related to a part of the brain's activity. This helps neurologists to pinpoint the origins of the seizure, and this can help to make surgery more effective in 10 to 20% of cases. Still not perfect, of course, but an enormous difference for those patients because they gain back control of their brains and bodies. And for them, it's a peaceful day at the market again.
Simon, thank you so much and well done. Way thank within you. The time, really, really, really well timed. So let's hear it from the jury. And I think it would be great to first give the floor to the chair of the jury, Reine Meilaerts.
Thank you very much. Sorry, first time for this. My question to you would be, if you were a troublemaker yourself, would you be pleased by your own research?
If I was a troublemaker?
Yes, on the market.
Well, then I figured I could get away with it still sometimes, of course, because the technique is sometimes still not informative, not effective. So as a troublemaker, you might get away with it, but then in a certain percentage of cases, you will get caught, especially if we are going to examine you several times. If a patient goes to the hospital several times, the chances that we discover something or we discover the troublemaker, the region in the head that causes the epilepsy, is going to be far greater.
Okay. Thank you. Marianne.
Thank you, Simon. This is very interesting and very impressive. What I wonder is, you say I can maybe 10 to 20% of the people, this can really make a difference. Does it mean for these people you can do surgery and otherwise you couldn't? Or can you do more selective surgery and hence save more brain functions? Or can you briefly quantify this impact for them?
Yeah. So I should add the nuance that in some patients we cannot perform surgery at all because the epileptic region overlaps with an important part of your brain that you need, for example, to speak. So those patients unfortunately cannot be treated. But then in the patients that are candidates for surgery, in let's say 20% of cases, EEG and fMRI has a critical impact in making that surgery successful.
Okay, thank you for your questions, dear jury. Unfortunately, time is up. A big hand once again to Simon. And ladies and gentlemen, we're off to the second candidate, and it is my great pleasure to announce to you Doreen Emmers. She's also from Belgium, is currently doing her PhD in economics, and she will talk about breaking the wall of early gaps in human capital formation. Doreen, the floor is yours.
Yueliang, Meigui, Yu. Moon, rose, fish. Three of the words that we all learned to read early on in primary school. Or rather, three of the words that we all learned to read early on in primary school if we come from relatively well-off backgrounds. Large socioeconomic inequalities in the opportunity of skill development persist. And such inequalities tend to be particularly large in developing countries. In China, for example, rural kids of 6-year-olds are able to read only half of the words that urban kids can read. And this, obviously, puts them at a huge disadvantage. Intervention programs targeted at such early skill gaps have been implemented, and as a sinologist, I've had the opportunity to get involved in the implementation of such programs. I do not pursue a PhD in sinology, though, but in economics. And what I contribute as an economist to this type of intervention research is that I use production functions to model the process of human skill development. I then include parental investments as key inputs in these production functions. And by parental investments, I mean all of the time, resources, efforts that parents spend on the development of their children. And then I allow for dynamic complementarity between all these types of investments. Let me illustrate the concept of dynamic complementarity with this relatively boring looking graph. My apologies, but this is the type of graph that economists love to use. The only thing that I would like for you to take away from this graph is that if parental investments are made at the right time and in the right order, they can be highly productive and there can be lots of dynamic complementarity, which implies that investments during later stages of childhood, during period 2 on this graph, will be even more productive. By contrast, if investments are not made at the right time and in the right order, they will be less productive and there will be little dynamic complementarity. In my research, I aim to use innovative analysis methods to quantify this type of dynamic complementarities, which is crucial to inform optimal policy design and to, hopefully, give more and more children the chance to learn how to read moon, rose, fish early on in primary school. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doreen, for your great presentation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we need to invest even more in our children, as I can see it right now. Thanks so much. Bart Geers, may I give you the floor to comment on the presentation?
Yes, thank you very much. Would you imagine I am Bill Gates and I have $1 billion to spend in social impact projects? Can you just in one sentence, you're with me in the elevator, in one or two sentences really describe why I would need to put some money into your project?
Because children need the basic skills, they need to build up more advanced skills later on in life, which they will need for to be a productive member of society.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Koen Wouters, any comments or questions?
A question. You stress on the importance
Could
of
you speak
parents?
A little bit louder in the microphone? Thank you.
You stress on the importance of the parents, the parental investment, but how do you reach those parents?
How do we reach them?
Yes.
So they are...
How do you convince them?
To participate?
Yes.
Well, they're invited to participate, either by to participate in home visits or in parenting training at centers. So they receive information, we use advertisement, and then if they do not want to participate, parenting trainers are sent to their homes to explain why it's important to invest early on in life, why reading to children before they can even speak is important. And if they then refuse to come, then so be it. But that's how we try to convince them, how we try to reach them. Is that what you wanted to know?
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you. Well, thanks for a great question and a great answer as well. Time is up for you as well, unfortunately. But ladies and gentlemen, a big hand to Dorina as well. Thank you. So now we're moving on to the third presentation of tonight, and that one will be given by Charles Margaritz. He's from the United States. He's into biochemistry, chemistry of alternative energy. He already won some fellowships as well, and he will be talking about breaking the wall of a net carbon zero economy. Charles, the floor is yours.
Have you ever stopped to realize that everything on this earth is solar powered? Consider this plant, for example. It can go from a seedling all the way into a mature and fruit-producing plant, utilizing only sunlight, water, and air. I can then eat the fruit from that plant, and I am solar powered. Similarly, this plant will die, and through geological processes that span millions of years, this plant will become oil and heat my home and drive my car. I have a solar powered car. Of course, this last form of energy is totally unsustainable, and the combustion of fossil fuels has had a very taxing impact on the environment of our planet. And so, what we need to do to create a sustainable future for future generations to be able to thrive in the way that those in the past have, we need to create something called a net carbon zero economy, where every carbon dioxide that we've put into the atmosphere can be recycled into a usable form of carbon that we can use again and again. This transformation can be accomplished by considering two aspects, energy generation and energy storage. Through photosynthesis, plants can extract energy from water, utilizing only sunlight, and turn it into a usable form of energy for the cell. Subsequently, a key enzyme called Rubisco can combine that energy with carbon dioxide to make sugar. This sugar then can be turned into long-term storage, or even go on to help the cell grow, or make the fruit that I will hopefully eat in the future. My goal as a scientist is to be able to take these great parts of plants and use them in a different context. I work with the microorganism Saccharomyces cerevisiae, and it is an industrial workhorse that can be easily manipulated to perform any task or create nearly any product that you so desire. And so you would know this microorganism best as yeast, from the bubbles in your bread, in your beer, and even the ethanol that goes into the fuel that's already used in your car. So I want to take this yeast and add the enzymes hydrogenase, which will help me convert the energy liberated from water splitting, and Rubisco, which will help me then store that energy in the form of ethanol or other carbon value products so that we can create a 100% renewable cellular factory. This newly made organism, when combined with the already existing massive infrastructure that exists for yeast manufacturing, should be able to produce chemicals, foods, and fuels on a scale that can actually meet society's needs. And in this way, we can lay the foundation for a sustainable, successful future and break the wall to the net carbon zero economy.
Well done, thank you so much. And of course, greening the economy, energy transition, they're very hot political buzzwords.
Yes.
But let's now hear it from the jury. So, Jason Passaris, can I give you the floor first?
Yes, thank you very much for the nice presentation. You talked briefly about scale at the end. You say there is already some big scale installations for yeast processes. So
yes.
I think I agree with that. What is the next step that we need in upscaling to actually reach meaningful percentages of this technology breaking through? And how big of a part of energy generation do you see this type of technology becoming alongside wind, solar, and all the other renewable sources?
Of course, yes. So you ask about how much we would need to scale. Of course, we would need to scale up to the level of petroleum refining, which is enormous. The existing infrastructure that we already have for yeast manufacturing, the largest of that manufacturing actually occurs in bioethanol production, which is already done on the billions of liters of scale. So the beneficial part of this project then would be to take the CO2 out of the atmosphere to create this. And so the scale up could be infinite as we need it to be, but ideally we would want to try and work our way into this infrastructure that already exists.
Okay, thank you. Ortwin de Graaf. You have a comment or question.
Okay, thank you very much. Usually when scientists tell me they're coming up with a new solution, I sort of see 100 years ahead and know that it's bringing us into new shit.
Yes.
Do you see risks involved in the processes that you're trying to model and then implement?
Of course, there's risks involved. The enzyme hydrogenase has not been expressed in yeast before in the function, in the form that I am trying to do so. So of course, that is a risk. But then I would say that that risk is outweighed by far by the fact that we can actually adapt to the existing infrastructure. So one of the main hurdles to getting the adoption of alternative energies is the fact that we're not set up for it, especially for liquid fuels, right? The only way we can access liquid fuels at the moment is through petroleum refining. And if we can utilize this new yeast system that I'm proposing, we can actually adapt straight in to the system. And so that, I think, would definitely lower the barrier to the adoption of alternative energies on a grand scale.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks for the questions. Also, a big hand to Charles. Thanks.
Thank you.
And now we're moving on to the next presentation, and it is my great pleasure to welcome Laurien van Dijk. She's from Belgium, did her master's in bioscience engineering, and last year already won a prize for the best pitch. And she's going to talk about breaking the wall of the ticking tumor bomb. The floor is yours, Laurien.
I just wasted like 5 seconds of your time. Why? Well, because I thought it was a good idea. Well, was it? This was 5 seconds. So imagine losing months or even years. Well, that is what 4 out of 5 cancer patients treated with immunotherapy go through. Why do they get the therapy? Well, because their doctor thinks it is a good idea. And that makes sense, because immunotherapy is indeed revolutionary. It wakes up the natural army of your body, the immune system, to find and kill the cancer cells. The other therapies kill the cancer cells and all the good cells in your body with it. But this one helps your body to kill the cancer for you. Amazing. But only for 1 out of 5 patients. The other 4, they suffer from the side effects, the personal and societal costs, and they lose time. Precious time they could have used to try another therapy. And therefore, it's extremely important to identify in time which patient will respond. And that is what I am doing. I get a tiny piece of a patient's tumor right before and after immunotherapy. And then I add another layer of revolutionariness, single cell technologies. The older techniques look at the mixture of all the cells together. But this baby looks at each single cell individually. It's like looking for Wally with your magnifying glass. We can see so much more details. And it would have saved us a lot of time as a kid, right? So, the result of all this revolutionariness is art. This is a real tumor, with each dot representing a single cell, and each color a cell type. So, I analyze these paintings of patients that respond and patients that do not respond. Are their immune cells actively fighting, or did they miss their alarm? And based on this behavior, I will discriminate future responders from non-responders. So in the end, my dream is to give the right treatment to the right patient, saving them from the side effects and the costs, but buying them time. Precious time. So after all, I hope I wasn't to you what my ex was to me. A waste of time. Thank you.
Thank you, Laurien. You're clearly very passionate about what you do, so it's lovely to see. Thank you so much. I'd like to ask Marianne to comment on the presentation.
Okay, thank you very much. This almost seems too good to be true. I can analyze and I can know for sure my treatment is going to work or not. How far are we on that already? How certain can you already distinguish between it's going to work or not? An interesting concept that proved some value, or do you already have pretty good matching with what you see then in actual patients?
What we have now in the clinic are not good biomarkers. So we really need to combine different ones. So that's why we are looking for a new one but we're not in the clinic yet. We're at the moment testing in a lot of patients, so really with patient samples, and we plan to validate in other clinical trials in the future, and then we really plan to go to the clinic. That's the point of this project, to get really societal impact, yes.
Okay, that'll be great.
Yeah.
Perfect. Koen Wouters.
I think nearly every cancer researcher now is working with single cell therapy, hoping that it will work. But what exactly is your part in your research?
You mean immunotherapy or single cell technology?
Single cell technology,
yes,
combined with immunotherapy.
What my personal part is, well, yeah, of course, it's a team effort. So I am analyzing one of the trials we are working with in the breast cancer patients. And I get a piece of the tumor from the clinic, and then we dissociate it in single cells, and we really analyze. So I analyze the data, I get these plots, and then I identify genes that are correlated with the response, because we know which patients will respond, because we also get a piece after therapy. And yeah, so I'm doing the analysis, I'm correlating, I'm contacting with the clinic, like this.
Okay. Laureen, thank you once again, and also a round of applause for Laureen.
Thank you.
So just checking with you, ladies and gentlemen in the audience, are you still having a bit of fun? Okay, good, good. Keep it up, keep it up. And also hopefully the audience at home, you're having a lot of fun as well. So we're coming to the fifth presentation of tonight. And it is my great pleasure to introduce to you Dries Dams. He's from Belgium. He did his PhD in archaeology, and he will be talking about breaking the wall of past, present, and future complexity. Dries, the floor is yours.
As an archaeologist, I'm always looking to learn from the past. In my work, I study and compare ancient societies and their complexity. Social complexity can be defined along three main flows: energy needed to sustain people, resources used to build and make things, and information exchanged to create social organization and institutions. Most of you would probably agree that our modern global society is much more complex than most societies in the past. But what does it mean for societies to be complex? And are we necessarily better off? Let's take a look at the past to explore some of these questions further. Almost 3,000 years ago, a village emerged in what is now Italy, called Rome. You may have heard of it. Over the next few centuries, Rome grew to become the center of a huge empire. The expansion of Rome was driven by the exploitation of energy and resources from an increasingly large area. But at the same time, the Romans facilitated this expansion by improving the exchange of information across the empire, most notably by building a huge road network to allow the movement of goods, people, and communication across their society. Roman society was very complex. Yet, you may have noticed, the Roman Empire is not around anymore. At some point, the Roman society collapsed. How did this happen? We can understand better the trade-offs between, we can better understand the growth and decline of societies through the trade-offs between complexity and sustainability. You see, it's not that hard for societies to grow more complex. All you need is to exploit more energy, use more resources, and exchange more information. The tricky part, though, is to stay complex. You see, complexity is a hungry beast, and it comes with a cost. As societies grow, they need ever more resources and energy to keep things going, making them less sustainable and more prone to collapse. The question is then, is it wise to be complex? I don't have the definite answer here. However, looking at the trade-offs between complexity and sustainability requires a long-term perspective, that is, an archaeological perspective. I do not know what the archaeologists of the future will learn from their past when they look at our times, but it is my hope that by better understanding the past, we gain an additional set of perspectives on our own choices regarding complexity and sustainability for the present as well as for the future.
Thank you, Dries, also for your contribution and really well timed. Let's move on to the jury. Reina, can I give you the floor?
Thank you, Dries, for a very, I shall not say complex presentation. Being interested myself in complexity theory, my question would be, do you see a role for the so-called edge of chaos in for a system to retain its, let's say, its stability?
There is, actually. So the perspective that I use in my work is based on complex systems thinking, so in which, of course, complexity theory has its part. The edge of chaos by itself I do not use because it's a bit too metaphorical as a concept, but I do link it more towards what is called a punctuated equilibrium, in the sense that you have phases of stability and phases of change, and that change can happen abrupt with no very apparent cause happening, whereas in other times nothing really special might be happening at all for a long time. And it's this punctuated change, this edge of chaos, as you might say, that is coming about through the interplay of energy, resources, and information that I talked about and that I define as the key, the core concepts of social complexity. So yes, it is there, but not as such.
Okay, thanks. I hope that answers your question. Bart Geers.
Thank you very much. Which is an intriguing presentation from my end. I just have a semi-rhetorical question for you. Did the Roman Empire actually collapse?
Probably. There are many different reasons, or there are many different hypotheses for the let's call it the disappearing of the Roman Empire. And of course, the word collapse is one with associations. It's presumes a sudden event and the Roman Empire is gone. We know that that was not the case in many regions where this process was much more extensive and new states and polities arised on the structures of the Roman Empire. That's very true. So the picture is not black and white, but very much gray, but that gray is very difficult to present in 3 minutes.
Thank you. I just wanted to say you could probably have a 4-hour debate on that afterwards. And you're more than welcome to do so afterwards.
Be
so.
Very happy.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, one big hand as well. Thank you. And then we're moving on to the next presentation, and it is my great pleasure to introduce to you Hava Istzi. She is from Belgium, does a PhD in healthcare and medical sciences, and she will be talking about breaking the wall of supervised machine learning. Hava, the floor is yours.
How many of you know 8Women? Breast cancer is the most common cancer in women worldwide, with 2 million people getting diagnosed each year. Relatively speaking, nowhere other in the world are there more breast cancer diagnoses than in Belgium, and this number is increasing. But there is a bright spot in this story. Survival is actually getting better because of the new treatments and technology from the last 20, 30 years. So people are actually living longer, but they have more chances to develop a recurrence in their lifetime. So, because of this, we wanted to look into recurrences, because the number for recurrences, it is actually not known. And therefore, we wanted to come up with a more efficient idea. So, it's quite simple. We will just use artificial intelligence or supervised machine learning. No. But this is not as complex or dangerous as it sounds, really. If you look at this picture, you might know what this is. It's a round dog. If it looks like a dog, it walks like a dog and barks like a dog, chances are it's a dog. Humans have learned with specific cues over the years that this is a dog and nothing else. So this is exactly what we wanted to do for breast cancer recurrences as well. So we wanted to look into the most important cues from recurrences and learn a machine this specific cues. So in Belgium, we have approximately 1.5 million registrations of hospital discharges and treatment lines for breast cancer patients every year. So we can use this to build this machine learning algorithm and get correct recurrences for all patients. So the thing is, artificial intelligence is not as smart as we think they are. They cannot detect specific cues on their own, so they need some guidance or supervision to be able to get this data. So for a sample hospital in which we knew which patient had recurrences, we trained an algorithm to be able to detect, classify these recurrences. So this way, the machine is learning and getting better by practicing, so eventually it will have recurrences for all patients in Belgium, like we can recognize all types of dogs. And this way, if we have 100% of all recurrences, we will be able to improve cancer treatments and will be able to help find a cure for this cancer.
Thank you, Hav, also for your contribution, and thank you so much for using the dog metaphor. That makes it for some people a bit easier to understand. Yeah. So let's move on to the jury. Jason Passeris, could you comment?
Yes, a question. So if I understand correctly, you're developing an algorithm?
Yes.
Or some algorithms. Do you see any spillover of your development of your algorithm into other diseases, other types of cancers, or maybe other domains entirely?
So definitely in some other type of cancers, there's a lot of overlap, because if you can use this in breast cancers, there's probably also a chance that you can do it in other cancers. For example, me, I'm also working on ovarian cancer as well, so other gynecological cancers we're looking to as well. And other diseases are actually trying this as well, so not only cancer recurrence, but other type of diseases, they're trying to collect this and get this data efficiently and use the data that we already have, so yeah.
Okay, perfect. Ortwin de Graaf.
Thank you very much for this interesting, but and to me, very surprising presentation. Surprising in the sense that, did I understand you correctly that Belgian women are the most at risk of having breast cancer, or the diagnosis is highest in Belgium?
The diagnosis is really high in Belgium. So in no other country are there more diagnoses in Belgium is 113 in 100,000 patient, mm-hmm. patients, 100,000 people that get it. So in no other country is it this high, the diagnosis.
Is that, what's the relation to the occurrence? Do we know, is there something about Belgium that makes it dangerous for women in that particular sense?
I think that's a more like epidemiological question, and I'm not sure.
Okay. Thanks for the question and also for your answers. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, a big hand to Hava.
Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on to the next labster, Robin Amsters. He's from Belgium. He's doing his PhD in engineering technology. He actually already won 2 Best Student Paper Awards, and he will be talking about breaking the wall of lost robots. Robin, the floor is yours.
This is Randy the robot. His purpose in life is to bring me coffee. But Randy has a problem. He's lost. Now, he could use GPS, but that doesn't work indoors. And Randy is also not rich, so he can't afford the expensive sensors that all of his friends have. And this makes Randy sad. Of course, a coffee robot is not very urgent, but indoor location enables so many things. Let's take a look at Randy's siblings, like Betty, the bed. She drives patients through the hospital so that nurses have more time and energy. Or what about Debbie, the defibrillator? She doesn't drive herself, but it is absolutely crucial that nurses can find her quickly. Luckily, Robin the human is here to help. And there are a few ways to do indoor positioning, but all the cool kids are using light these days. Indoors, you need light anyways, so why not make the most of it? And that is exactly what I do. I switch the lights on and off very quickly, and we can't see that, but robots can, and they can use it to figure out where they are. For example, let's say that Randy sees a light flickering 1,000 times per second. That might mean that he's in the hallway. With multiple lights, he can narrow that down. And most systems need to see 3 lights at the same time to get an exact location. But I've found a way that works with just one. And we don't even have to see it all of the time, just some of it. I've achieved that by combining light with other sensors, such as those that measure acceleration. And that gives us a rough idea of how our robot moves, and light then gives more precise location fixes. All sensors have their own weaknesses, but the combination is better than the sum of its parts, and it makes light positioning actually possible outside of a lab. Sadly, there's one more problem that other researchers keep ignoring. How do you know where your lights are? You could manually measure this, but that takes a long time. So instead, I taught Randy how to do this. He just drives around and does all the measuring for me. He can do it about as fast as I can, but without all the complaining. So this means that Randy is now officially one of the cool kids. But let's hope he's not too cool to still bring me coffee.
Thank you so much. Just to wrap it up, Randy, Betsy, Robin, and a bunch of lights.
Yeah.
Okay, that's perfect. No, then we understand each other. Very good. Dear jury, I'd like to also involve you again. Can I ask Koen Wouters to comment?
Excellent presentation, but the lights you use for the light positioning, are just the ordinary lights in a room, or sunlight, or specially placed lights?
It works best with LEDs, because they're easy to control. You can do it with fluorescent light if you really want to, but since we're phasing those out anyways, there is an opportunity to, for new LED lighting installations, immediately include this.
Perfect. Marianne Verhels, can I ask you to comment or ask a question?
Yes. I'm very happy that Randy can do the job for you and he doesn't complain. Of course, he will only complain if he doesn't start to bump into everything, because then it just stops working and then you're out of business anyway. So can you use the same technology to prevent robots to bump into each other? Because that's also important for the navigation, besides knowing where they are.
Yeah. You can't use it to prevent collisions. You still need some way to general perception. But since I use a camera to detect the light, you could also use that for perception. Or if we already have accurate, but what happens right now is that the sensors for perception and navigation are the same, and they're very expensive. But if you have cheap localization sensors, then your perception can be much cheaper. So like your overall cost goes down.
Okay, pretty cool, thanks.
Okay. Thank you. Wonderful. Ladies and gentlemen, a big hand to Robin.
Thank you.
And we're moving on to the next candidates, and it is my great honor to introduce to you Margot Winters. She's from Belgium, currently doing a bachelor in mathematics and physics, won a prize last year in astronomy, and she'll be talking about breaking the wall of star birth. Margot, the floor is yours.
Have you ever seen a star being born? Sounds ridiculous, right? But I'm sure you have, actually, without even realizing. See, most of us probably saw an image just like this one on the internet before. But did you realize that every single color in it tells us different things about what is really going on in that galaxy? For instance, all pink dots in this image are really old stars being born. Now, this image is what we see if we look with our eyes using a telescope. On the right is what we see if we look with a magnet. because you might not expect it, but galaxies behave just like bar magnets do. Now, my project is to study exactly how this magnetism influences the way stars are born. And for this, data from images like these two behind me are the main sources of information. However, when the problem is that galaxies are incredibly far away, so this means that just like with any normal camera, the images become really, really blurry. So this means that unfortunately, we don't know yet how magnetism influences star formation for all these distant galaxies. Now I've become very, very intrigued by this problem ever since I was in high school 2 years ago. And in fact, I couldn't see it any different, because for me, understanding this universe truly feels like this one purpose of our existence. So throughout the years, I carefully selected about 30 distant galaxies across our entire universe that I am sure will provide a solution. And I based the selection on various aspects, but the most important one being that every single one of these galaxies is positioned in this very specific way in space. Namely, there has to be another galaxy placed right behind it, like this. And surprisingly, studying the light rays coming from that background galaxy actually tells us heaps about the strength of the magnet of the foreground galaxy we actually wanted to observe. So I'm confident that using these results together with those pink starburst dots I showed you will actually be able to provide us with that breakthrough we really needed to know how magnetism influenced starburst in all those distant galaxies. Now for some nearby galaxies, we already know that strong magnets cause massive stars to be born. However, only an approach like this one will be able to really confirm or deny whether this still holds for very distant galaxies. I believe that only then we will be able to look at our night sky and feel like we understand why it is that all these beautiful flickering stars around us have come to existence. Thank you very much.
Margot, thanks for your presentation. I can see you like details because the little woman in the presentation wears the same dress you are wearing right now. Well done, very clever. Dear jury, I'd like to ask Bart Geers to comment on the presentation.
Thank you very much for the presentation, which was also fashion-wise, indeed, very intriguing. Just a question. How do you think now stars are born? And what in the end can we humble human beings do with this knowledge, What do you think about it?
So stars are born in huge clouds of molecules and gas and dust, a cloud that collapses and forms our sun, for example, but also it contained everything that you see around you today. Every little thing, every atom was contained in those clouds that formed us. So that's part of the answer. And the second part of the answer I'd like to give is, I see where you're coming with this, you know? There is always this part about astronomy, what are those direct applications to it? Why could we use this? How can this solve poverty in the world or may it cure all diseases? But truth is, it can't. But does it truly matter? I don't think so. Because I think I started to think I want to become an astronomer once I realized that once we stop caring about our origin and existence in this universe, we might as well just stop existing, because I feel like there would be no point. For me, this is fundamental and it goes beyond having applications. It is not fundamental because it would have applications, it's fundamental because this is why we're here.
And a final comment by Reine, perhaps?
Thank you. You have convinced me. But if I would be Donald Trump, how would you convince him?
Can anyone really convince Donald Trump? If I were to want to convince Donald Trump in the first place, I'd probably give it a very nationalistic twist to make sure it benefits America. Furthermore, I don't think any scientific proposal really would be interesting to Trump if it was not to be something he will benefit for. So I would make it beneficial for him. I definitely would make it beneficial for him.
Thanks, Margot. I'm truly impressed by your answer and the difficult question. Okay, ladies
Thank
and gentlemen, a big hand to Margot. So, dear audience, we have three presentations left, so I do hope you still have a lot of energy to witness those final presentations as well. And it is my great pleasure to introduce to you Alexander Cruz. He's from the Philippines, is doing his PhD in bioscience engineering and won quite some prizes already. And he'll be talking about breaking the wall of nanomaterials in healthcare diagnostics. Alexander, the floor is yours.
The most sensitive sensor out there is not the device that police officers will put into your mouth on a drunk Friday night back when we can still do it, where you have to do this. It's just because this sensor is not sensitive enough to detect the alcohol levels in your breath of whether you're breaking the law or not. Because up until this day and age, the most sensitive sensors we have is, you guess it right, a dog. Or more specifically, a dog's nose. That's why they come around in airports sniffing into your bags to check whether you have items or substances that are not allowed in your luggage. Studies have shown that dogs can do so much more than that, that they can actually be trained to detect early signs of diseases traced in human breath, such as lung cancer. And this is a topic that's very personal to me because my grandmother got diagnosed with a late-stage respiratory illness. Imagine if they could just walk around and sniff into your breath and tell you, hey, it's time to go for a visit to the doctor. That would be great, but may not be very practical. In the last 4 years of my research, I've been looking for a way to integrate a sensor that is as powerful as a dog's nose in your smartphone. Let me show you how it works. Your breath is composed of many different types of gas molecules that assume certain shapes and sizes. There's a material in the chemistry lab that we've been working on called metal organic frameworks, or MOFs, M-O-Fs. These are very small molecules, like a sponge, with holes of about 1 nanometer. That's 100,000 times smaller than the diameter of a human hair. You can design in it such a way that you can fit a certain gas molecule and will then act as your super sensitive sensor when integrated into an electronic device. The shapes and size can vary so that you can use it to detect markers of diseases traced in human breath, toxic gases for indoor air quality monitoring, or even odors coming from spoiled food to check whether your leftover food in the fridge is still good after 5 days. In 5 years' time, when we're looking at commercializing this technology, maybe this dog's nose in your smartphones can help us be better prepared for the next pandemic, so that we can see those smiles behind those masks. Or maybe more grandparents can attend their grandchildren's graduation parties. Or better yet, I believe and I hope that this could revolutionize the healthcare sector. Ladies and gentlemen, why don't you join me in my cause right here at Europe's innovation capital as I break the walls of nanomaterials for healthcare diagnostics for the better future for mankind. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot for your presentation, Alexander. So if it's a dog's nose, it can smell good things and bad things, I guess. I'm not going to ask you any further questions. I probably don't want to know. Okay, dear jury, Yasin, would you like to comment or ask a question?
Yes, I was going to say ask something about sniffing dogs in Corona, but you covered that in the last sentence, so I'm going to ask something else. Something that bugs everyone with a smartphone, the battery use. Mm-hmm. So we're going to add yet another sensor to this tiny device. Do you have any ideas about energy usage of this kind of technology? And will it not just drain the battery that we have to carry around chargers and extra mm-hmm. batteries all the time?
Yes, so the question was touching upon energy storage on devices. I think this only highlights the interdisciplinary work that we have to put in this kind of work. So in my field, we're not only working with chemists and material scientists, but we're also working with engineers in different microfabrication facilities in Leuven and IMEC outside of Belgium so that we can be able to develop a process compatible with microfabrication techniques that will seamlessly facilitate the integration of such sensors and these devices. Yes, it will consume energy, but we will find ways to reduce a bit here, reduce a bit there, to be able to put this in a timely fashion.
Perfect, thank you. Bart van de Graaf.
Thank you.
Would you turn on the microphone, please?
Wrong
thank
button.
You.
Exciting prospects. You make it sound like it's going to happen tomorrow. What do you see are the major hurdles for making this really market ready and risk-free in terms of reliability, especially for diagnostic purposes?
I may be a visionary, but the risk that I'm looking at is not speaking to each other, not communicating. As I've shared earlier, this is an interdisciplinary work. Chemists play in their playground to build those MOF materials, while the microfabrication engineers, the electrical engineers, the device fabrication do their work. If we don't communicate our hurdles with each other, we won't be able to find a solution. And this is what we want to prevent. So let's work together.
Perfect. Ladies and gentlemen, also a round of applause for Alexander.
Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to introduce to you for the next presentation, Amelie Franken. She's from Belgium, is doing her PhD in biomedical sciences, and she's going to talk about breaking the wall of one size fits all. The floor is yours.
I'm afraid I have some bad news. You're diagnosed with cancer. We have to decide on a treatment plan. One of the options is very promising, immunotherapy. Unfortunately, it works only for 20% of cancer patients. You may experience side effects, and if you do not respond to this treatment, it will cost us precious time. Would you like me to clarify some things before we decide? Feel bad? Me too. And that is why my research will tackle this scenario. As you heard, current techniques don't allow us to predict which therapy will benefit which patient. Physicians and patients take a shot in the dark, hence important treatment decisions are based on trial and error. One thing is clear, when it comes to cancer therapy, one size does not fit all. To tear down this wall and offer patient-tailored therapy, I try to fully understand how a tumor works. How do I do this? Well, so far, tumor tissue has been studied as a whole, while focusing on the target, the cancer cells. But when we shed light on the tumor and divide it into separate cells, it gets clear that the tumor is much more diverse than previously thought. Immune cells, for instance, which will attack the tumor with the help of immunotherapy, got overlooked. By characterizing and comparing all cells separately, between patients from tumors from responding patients and non-responding patients, I can identify in which cell something went wrong. This would not be possible if we look at the tumor in its entirety, as a link between a certain cell and its impact on treatment outcome is lost. Some may compare it to finding Wally, but I will talk about the real deal. Think of it as a smoothie. If one of the fruits has gone bad, you will taste it. But by looking at the smoothie as a whole, you will never know which fruit caused the bad taste. By analyzing the fruit separately, however, using high tech, you can identify the one responsible and do something about it. Throw it out. Well, this is what I try to do with a tumor. I characterize individual cells to detect which cell is the reason why the tumor does not respond to the therapy. And from this knowledge, we can not only predict response, but also create new therapies that target these cells. As such, we ensure that all cancer patients receive the most optimal treatment at the right time by shedding light on the bigger picture. Feel better? I do.
Thank you. What a wonderful presentation, Amelie. Thank you very much also for your contribution. Dear jury, I'd like to move on to you again. Koen Wouters, can I ask you to comment?
I wonder, I said to your colleague, Laureen van Dijk, that single cell sequences is hot. So what exactly is the difference between your research and hers?
Well, actually, Laureen and I are joining forces. So we come from the same lab. And together with a whole team, we're actually analyzing different types of cancer, lung cancer, breast cancer, head and neck cancer, to also identify differences, but also similarities between these cancers. This is a huge project, which will eventually lead to biomarkers that are predictive for response. Yes.
Okay, perfect. Marianne, can I ask you to comment?
Okay. So what you and I guess your colleague are doing is basically increasing the amount of information you have access to make better decisions, because you kind of split out all these different cells and try to look at them individually. It's an information explosion, I can guess, in your field. And I come from an electrical engineering background, working on machine learning, where obviously, if you have to deal with a lot of information, these things, these techniques help. Is this also something you're working with, artificial intelligence or machine learning models, or are they not appropriate for you for certain reasons?
Not yet, but this is where we're going to, exactly. Because right now we're looking at three aspects of these cells, the genome, epigenome, and proteome. So this uses, generates huge amounts of data, which we need exactly to produce algorithms that will be able to get around all the data. So this is definitely the future, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you also for this question and your answer. Ladies and gentlemen, a big hand also to Amelie. And then last, but certainly not least, ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to also introduce to you Frans Dopperé. He's from Belgium, did his PhD in archaeology, and he will be talking about breaking the walls of stone carving techniques on fallen walls. The floor is yours.
Not many people care about stone carving techniques, but I do. Usually, people see a fallen wall, but I'm looking at traces of stone carving techniques because I can feel people at work about 2000 years ago, including their petites histoires. On the left side, you have an example of a punched dressing with a peak. Right, you see the pointed claw chisel. Two different techniques, left a rough carving, right a fine carving. Very interesting for chronology, but I do more with those data. This is an example of such a fallen wall of a second century fountain. At the right side, the raw carving, and at the left half of the monument, you see the fine carving. And the limit between the two techniques runs even over single stones. So we have a monument cut in two halves. Additionally, we see on the steps below that also the stairs have been delivered in two batches, depending on the position of the stonemason's marks, the black triangles. We know that this fountain was ordered by a certain Tiberius Claudius Piso, but that he left the erection of the monument to two of his heirs. And now comes the truth. Because we know there are two hairs, we have two different stone carving techniques, we have two different batches for the steps, that leads immediately to the conclusion that here we see a disagreement between the two commanders of this building. And thus, a wise lesson: when building your houses, never have a dispute, because soon or later an archaeologist is going to find it out, because we simply love to do that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and Franz, if you can join me here. But I think you want people to have a dispute, because then there's more work for you to be done, right?
Of course, yes.
Exactly. So jury, the final time I'm calling upon your answers. Reine, could you give some feedback? Thank you.
Thank you. Of course, I'm intrigued about all these disputes. would be the pyramids in Egypt also a good object to study for you? Would you discover more?
Well, I can tell you that in principle, any monument in the world could be a good study subject. And in fact, the first aim, what I explained to you, was chronology. So I'm dating buildings by using these stone carving techniques. But all the other aspects of the social life of the people is some additional present, in fact, that we as an archaeologist receive when we study these tiny traces on the stone. It's quite unexpectedly in certain occasions, but I'm sure if you would invite me to go to Egypt, I would find something nice.
Bart Geers, could ask you to comment as well.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. Intriguing again. Just a tiny question. Are you really sure the guys had a dispute?
Well, suppose that you're building a house. I'm not talking about my fountain again. You're building a house. And from outside, I can see that the white part of your house is built in natural stone, the left part of your house is built in brick. The first thing that I'm going to ask myself, what is happening inside that house? Maybe I will ring and say, didn't you have a problem? Or what is the reason for that? So when you see odd things like that, when you, to return to my fountain, when you order a building, the first thing that you do, that is to ask to the architect and to the stone carver, well, give me this building, but do it all the time the same way. That is logic. When you see a difference between right and left, that is no longer logic. And then we start to think about possible reasons. I've not said that they have really quarreled, but I'm thinking about it.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, also a very big applause for Franz. Okay. So, dear audience, and also everyone at home, we've seen all the presentations. So once again, thank you so much for the presentations from the labsters, but also the jury for your comments, and everyone, of course, for watching online. And now, of course, as I told you before, this is the opportunity for you to cast your vote. And let me just check if the link to the vote, yes, the link for the vote has come onto the screen. So you can vote for your favorite candidates via the link that you can see on the screen. So what I suggest to do, right now the jury is going to have a meeting. They'll come up with their own candidates. You as an audience will come up with your candidates. And then I would say at 22:10, so 21:40, we will come back, convene, and then we will continue with the award ceremony. In the meantime, once again, please cast your vote, and we are going to entertain you with a couple of videos of the Falling Walls labs so that you also have an idea what the candidates can expect when joining in the international competition. So, looking forward to having you back online at 22:10. Thank you very much. We'll be right back.
it's this incredible connection of people, and I find myself just going, wow.
It's about what science can do and what society can become.
What was science fiction has now become science.
Falling walls, what a great image.
These robots are human-made systems, and so we're gonna need to work together.
In future, we can do better, and we must.
Science always build bridges, and I'm very proud to be part of it.
It's a unique event of that kind.
Speakers that take us to the edge of our understanding.
Bang. Great. So trying to think that this was the beginning of time makes no sense at all.
I'm gonna show you the audience tonight.
Will you help me shine a light on this incredibly urgent issue?
This conference is all about getting walls to break down so that we don't damage humanity.
The fundamental question is, are we alone?
Breaking the wall means opening new windows and discovering the unexpected that can be fantastic.
Yeah, wow, isn't that wow?
The signal of two black holes coalescing. This is what it sounds like.
Through your commitment and your effort, you will create a better future.
It's time to act. It's urgent. Do it now.
I have not seen anything else like that worldwide.
I really enjoy putting my ideas into relation to what's possible in terms of innovation.
Such a great opportunity for innovators to share ideas with people who can actually make them happen.
We can design a Spider-Man suit. It's not impossible.
This is a rapid fire boot camp for young scientists from the entire world.
Falling Walls Venture shows that the excellence of basic research can turn into proud entrepreneurial solutions.
The rich diversity of science communicators across the world doing amazing things.
Falling Walls has pulled together an international group of luminaries. For me, is really a dream come true.
Here I get new perspectives.
That was really inspiring.
Brilliant researchers. It's such an incredible atmosphere.
I've been learning a lot of interesting things.
Overall, I think it's a huge message of hope that you get.
There are walls everywhere. Let's bring them down.
That's how it goes.
3 minutes was short, shorter than you think it is.
3 minutes, it's enough to say what's the purpose, what's the problem you want to solve, how you're gonna do it, and what does it take.
What you're looking at right now is the first schematic for a cure for the deadliest infectious disease known to humanity.
talk a lot, so at different presentations I see myself running beyond time. So the participation has helped me learn how to carve my story and then present it in a pitch form in a very short time.
Thank you very much.
I really fell in love with this event because it brings together all the great minds on one stage.
You need to be also out of the box in order to share, to feed your own research with the contact with the others.
I hope that the future sees more collaborative efforts like this, where people come together, bring in different strengths, and fusing those together to solve complex problems. And science will be key to that journey.
Seeping up my energy.
But it's right to spend the night. We start a fight. I wanna fly. I reach the sky.
Ladies and gentlemen, the audience here in Leuven, but also online, I'd like to welcome you back for the award ceremony. I hope you had a good break and that you were able to cast your vote. So how are we going to run this final part of the program? Well, as said, we are going to have a couple of awards. There will be a third place, a second place, a first place, and those are the ones selected by the jury. And then finally, we also have a audience winner. But before we go to award those prizes, I'd like to hand over first of all to Reine Melaerts to tell us a little bit more about the jury verdict.
Thank you. So good evening once again on my behalf also. Good evening to the candidates, good evening to the audience, good evening to the members of the jury. And okay, we tried to do a very good job and we have for now selected the three winners, and you have selected the winner of the audience award. But forgive me for having a bit more or making a bit more of suspense. I would first of all, this is also important, I would like to first of all take the opportunity to thank a number of people. And of course, I would like first to start to thank the candidates. You who have made this evening, you who have come here to present your research in not so easy circumstances, not only because it is we have this pandemic, but also because being here in front of an audience and having this challenge to do, I think that is something that is quite difficult. But anyway, you did a very good job. I think you will remember this for the whole of your life, not only because of the suspense, not only perhaps because of the stress, but also because it is a very rewarding experience, an experience of which you learn very much, even if you don't realize it fully today, tonight, what you have learned. I'm sure that you will take that with you for the rest of your life. Believe me, if you don't believe me for now, you will believe me later. Anyway, thank you to the candidates. Thank you also to the members of the jury, Ortwin de Graaf, Marianne Verhelst, Koen Wouters, Bart Geers and Jason Passaris. I think we have worked very hard and we have chosen the very best candidates to give prizes to, but more about that later. I would also like to thank Bas Birker, yes, who is there, and the candidates know him very well. He has worked very hard, yes, indeed. He has worked very hard with the candidates to make their performance even better, and I think we have seen what was the good result of all that. A warm thank you also to you, Charlotte, for making this evening a very nice experience, giving a good introduction to all the candidates and helping us to run everything smoothly. And then finally, I would like to thank also all the people from the Research Coordination Office and from the Science Coordination Office. You might imagine what it takes to organize such an evening, and moreover what it takes to organize such an evening in these circumstances. But I think once again they did a very good job. It was not so nice to be here with all our masks. I'm happy to to be here now that I can take off my mask. But anyway, thank you for a very good job, and I would like to ask also a warm applause for the people behind the scene who have made all this possible. Thank you. Now I hand over to Charlotte.
Thank you, Reine, for the very kind words, and indeed it's much appreciated that you hand over those kind words. But we're not there yet, because now we're going to move over to the exciting part, which is the awards ceremony. Just for logistics purposes, it's good to know that we're going to ask the candidates that have been awarded a prize to join us here on stage, and there will be a 3, a 2, and a 1 indicated over here, and the audience winner can actually join us next to me. So I hope you're ready. I'm just going to check with the audience if that's okay with you, Reine. Are you ready?
Of course.
Okay. Woo. Good. So I'm going to hand over the envelope for the third place to you to open up. There you go.
So, ladies and gentlemen, the third place goes to Margot Winters.
Thank you.
heeft dit ook aan. Okay. And the whole universe, of course.
Okay. Well done.
Congratulations.
Okay.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much for joining us here. Then we're going to move over to the second place.
Second place, it's not Wout van Aert. It's Charles Margaret.
Thank you very much.
There you are, it's second prize.
Congratulations. So, ladies and gentlemen, in case you're wondering what the prizes are, the third and the second place got a cartoon, which is actually a reflection of the title of this event, namely Falling Walls. And I'm sure later on you can also have a closer look. And now we're going to move over to the first place, who's also going to have a cartoon. But on top of that, ladies and gentlemen, this person will get access to the International Forum of the Falling Walls Lab, and so does the audience winner afterwards. But first of all, ladies and gentlemen, the first place.
Thank you. And the first place goes to Robin Amsters.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Well done. Congratulations.
Oh my God.
Someone is quite astonished, I can say.
Nice. It's also for Betsy and.
You have to share with Randy and Betsy. Yeah, exactly. Okay. Well, we have come to the final prize awards, and that will be the audience winner. So that is the person that you, as an audience, voted for. So I'm very excited to see who this is going to be.
Audience award. Alexander Kroes. Congratulations. I have no cartoon for you, but
Okay, thank you.
Congratulations. Please join us here. And ladies and gentlemen, this is it. I'm going to finish it and wrap it off with just a small question to all the prize winners. You just have to answer with yes or no. Going to start with Margot. Did you expect this? Okay. Did you expect this?
No.
Okay, you're so honest. Robin, did you expect this?
No.
Alexander?
No.
Okay, so you must be super, super happy. But on top of that, also a big thanks to all the other candidates. It really was high quality. It was an absolute pleasure to listen to. I wish you too, Robin and Alexander, all the best of luck at the International Falling Walls Lab taking place very soon, which is also a digital event. Thanks to all of you for joining us today, both here in the room at the cinema in Leuven, but also online, and I hope to see you next year. Please stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Celebrate good times, come on.
Yeah, it's on. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, just a remark for all of you. We need to access this room row per row. So I suggest you all go back to your spots. Sorry about that. Thank you. Okay. And then we'll start with, shall we start at